Hello, my name is Cory Garden, and I'm presenting on the vicious circle of growth, which is this third chapter in Jean Baudrillard's book, Consumer Society: Myths and Structures. Just a quick note about Jean Baudrillard. He believes consumption is the major feature of Western society's global response. Basically, his theory is consumption has become a means of differentiation, not satisfaction. It's not about fulfilling your needs and getting satisfaction out of it. An important note to remember too about Baudrillard is his philosophy kind of measures social growth as a true indicator of growth versus economic growth. So that's important to know when examining what slant his argument is coming from. So first of all, there's four main focuses in his reading, and they're collective expenditure and redistribution, environmental nuisance, the accounting of growth, or the GNP, the gross national product, and the fourth one is waste. So the first one is collective expenditure and redistribution. Redistribution is fairly straightforward, but what is collective expenditure? I never knew what it was. I had to kind of look it up, but after kind of reading what it's about, you can read Wikipedia's explanation here, but it's basically about taxes. Taxes are dished out, a certain percentage of them, to society and members of society to service certain needs that society has to become dependent on, such as social services, hospitals, that kind of thing, education. So the main purpose of that is to reduce the inequality of distribution of resources. So you don't have, all the rich basically getting everything they can because they can pay for it and everybody else is suffering. So it's to kind of compensate for that. Baudrillard kind of gives some data back in his time. This book was written in 1970. So he came up with kind of percentages of what taxes are dished out proportionally in this consumer circle. So back in 59, 13% of kind of redistribution was given out. 6 years later, it was 17%. So he noticed or he talked about a trend that's developing. Within this kind of redistribution and how government is proportioning this disparity. So if you kind of look at his trend projectively, so the 21st century, there's going to be a dramatic increase in that redistribution, which anybody kind of looking at these graphs will kind of say, well, there's a dramatic increase in redistribution, which would be the normal kind of analysis from that. But that might not be necessarily so. When going back to 65's data on the redistribution, and remember that back in 1965, this pie chart shows that 17% is what was kind of allocated in the whole consumer circle. So out of that 17%, this is how the money was dispersed. And you can see that there's a dramatic increase in redistribution and collective expenditure in education, culture, sport, healthcare, things of that nature, which would lead one to believe that with this, especially with it projected towards the 21st century, that there's going to be greater equality within people, more of a balanced society. That's what one would think. But Baudrillard's really asked, does this state expenditure or these taxes make for an objective equalization of social chances? And I guess what he means by that is social inequalities becoming more of a leveling field? Well, Baudrillard argues that no, it doesn't. He says that these figures have no meaning, and the increase in available resources has to be interpreted in its real social logic. Social redistribution and its effectiveness has to be questioned. So my interpretation of that is, although there are increases in social services, so to speak, which in economic discourse equates to growth and higher standards of living, there is no social growth or leveling of inequalities. So then what kind of growth are we striving for? That is Baudrillard's main argument. And again, if you remember his philosophy about social growth, he comes from more of a humanitarian kind of standpoint rather than an economic one. So on his second focus is about something he calls environmental nuisance, kind of, because we do benefits from this. So how much of a nuisance is it? An interesting kind of definition of nuisance, if you guys would, what do you guys think of nuisance? How do you guys define it? Well, Oxford kind of defines it as an act which is harmful or offensive to the public or a member of it and for which there is a legal remedy, which I kind of question that definition because how much of a remedy really is there when everything is kind of capital-based? So there's some serious environmental nuisances that Baudrillard talks about, and that's the air and water quality that we have to deal with, things of that nature. They are all consequence, though, however, of industrial development and technical progress. And also, on the other hand, they're a consequence of the various structures of consumption. So, again, it's this vicious circle that we're kind of caught in. But, as Baudrillard kind of points out, what does this matter? All this pollution springs new industries, which is great for economy. It'll all be totted up as consumption, according to the GMP. And under the GMP, it is an indication of growth and wealth. So as I said, one can only marvel at the insane acceptance of this cancerous growth. And as Baudrillard states, once this cancer has passed a certain threshold, or he said once it has passed a certain threshold, extra productivity is almost entirely wiped out, swallowed up by this homeopathic treatment of growth by growth. So it's kind of, I mean, you can decipher his statement there in a few different ways, but basically I think, you know, what it's saying is it just kind of, it's like a cancer that just kind of grows on itself and feeds on itself. And I love how he gave this interesting kind of semiotic metaphor towards that of a wheel, where he says a threshold where the wheels turn but do not advance, where the entire increase in productivity goes into maintaining the system's condition of survival. I think this really represents kind of this circle he's talking about. And if you look at this image of a wheel spinning and smoke coming off, it's the way you could look at our consumer society, where it doesn't really go anywhere. You just create a lot of pollution and it kind of feeds off itself. And it doesn't really go anywhere. It's very, very destructive. He also quotes E. Lyle under this topic. And E. Lyle says that the major cost of the consumer society is the sense of generalized insecurity it engenders. And I think that's kind of what it means is we all feel kind of dependent on it. We have to buy, we have to work, we have to make a living. We're all trapped in this consumer society, and so there's an insecurity to that, that you can't detach from that. You're dependent on it, and it causes anxieties, as we've seen, and a whole bunch of other effects on society. And Baudrillard says, you know, this ultimately leads to the system, as it were, devouring itself, like a cancer, basically becoming parasitic upon itself. So you can see that it's very destructive. The third kind of focus he touches on is the accounting of growth and how we measure that in our society, or as Baudrillard refers, the mystique of GNP, the gross national product. So he kind of he talks on how economists input this data into the GNP and how they reflect upon how our economy is doing and everything else. And if you read his quote, you can kind of get a glimpse of how it's kind of hard to decipher Baudrillard's text sometimes. But after you read this, you can kind of get the idea that it's kind of a magic show going on, how they put in the numbers to how well our economy's doing. And the reason that it's a bit of a magic show is because they take all the negative effects to this consumer cycle, this vicious circle of growth, and equate it as something that's good. So it doesn't matter if you're talking about the nuisances that we're talking about, the poor quality of life, the air and water and damage to our environment, or the obsolescence and the damage that's formulated from this, opposed to the, you know, all the good stuff in the economy that you spend on movies, cars, all the stuff from the sex industry and drugs. It doesn't matter whether it's negative or bad, it's all money. It all creates new industries. It's all a sign of growth, according to these economists and the GNP, which is ridiculous. But this is the argument that Baudrillard states. But also, Baudrillard says that this kind of argument, it's kind of logical when you look at the consumer cycle. The negative aspects of consumer society, the compensation required, the social and environmental costs, are all key elements which Baudrillard says play the dynamic role of economic engine in that setup. So it's the driving factor of that. As much as we petition and protest against these nuisances, Baudrillard says we have to accept the hypothesis that all these nuisances somewhere enter into the equation as positive factors, as continual factors of growth, as boosters of production and consumption. It's kind of insane. So the final kind of focus on his chapter on the vicious circle of growth is about waste. And when you hear this term, most people will think about garbage and all that kind of waste, but that's just kind of one kind of aspect of waste. That's more of the pollution that's created. Waste, in this text context, he's talking about how we waste our money and how we produce things with an intent of destroying it so we can just continue on with more, to buy more. It's that obsolescence that's built into everything. So it's kind of based on that throwaway society term that most of us have probably heard about. The moral definition of consumption questions use value versus exchange value. Like, we don't need it for a specific use anymore, necessarily. It's all about how it makes us look, what we can get for it, what our image, how our image is strengthened because of it, that sort of thing. The human race also squanders any accumulated wealth as it exploits natural resources. So that kind of means that it's any wealth that we accumulate, we quickly throw it away for the next thing that's big and popular. And at the same time, this is kind of ruining our environment. And Baudrillard says, in short, waste is always considered a kind of madness, of insanity, of instinctual dysfunction, which causes man to burn his reserves and compromise his survival conditions by irrational practice, which is, again, just kind of a term that he uses to explain this excessive consumption. He says we're not really in an era of real affluence. Society lives with a constant notion of scarcity, which means that we always feel we need more. We're always, you know, we always need more. We don't have quite enough. That's not real affluence, in Baudrillard's opinion. All societies have always wasted, squandered products of consumption to make them feel alive, he says. There's a sense of aliveness or existence that we need, and we can only do that by consuming constantly. So this destruction also gives rise to a new social function within society. This wasteful expenditure, as Baudrillard calls it, is seen as a tradition in a long line of upper social classes asserting their preeminence, which means that we've always equated waste and kind of that kind of affluence with people who can afford to do so. It started, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years ago with the rich kind of showing, you know, if you even think of the old King Henry image of him taking one bite of a chicken leg or something and then throwing it away, it's kind of because he can. It's a sign of his strength and his eminence and his power and his wealth. Baudrillard says it's one of the fundamental problems posed by consumption is the following. Do human beings organize themselves for purposes of survival or in terms of the individual or collective meaning they give to their lives? So it's not about getting things to survive. It's not about their use value or utility value. It's about what does this make me look like? What is it? How does it strengthen my image? How does it make me a part of this social status that I want to be a part of? This value of feeling alive, of being, is at the center of consumption. So Baudrillard asks, does this not influence ultimately only have meaning in wastage? Which, that's another way in which Baudrillard talks that explain affluence is kind of synonymous with wastage. And it's kind of funny because we could certainly survive without the affluence we desire, thus drastically reducing our waste. We could easily live a more simplistic lifestyle, but it's because of society and its stratification and statuses that we feel that we need to be a part of this somehow. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, it's just trying to fit in, and because of this we get caught in this kind of vicious circle. And he also says that it is illusory to wish to reduce it, to aspire to eliminating it, for it is waste in some way which orientates the whole system. So by wasting things, by throwing away your cell phone, your computer, you're buying new things. At the same time, everybody has this wish to eliminate all the waste and pollution in this world, but yet we kind of feel kind of stuck to keep buying whatever else is new out there. It's just kind of, and you know, that's perpetuated through media and all other sorts of techniques. Also, this is portrayed in media quite a bit in this kind of heroes of consumption kind of theory. Society and media portray this as something to aspire to. Baudrillard says that they fulfill a very precise social function, that of sumptuary, useless, inordinate expenditure. So we kind of giving, you know, through movies and media and images, we're given this kind of image that, you know, it's good to go out and get rich and, you know, aspire to these great goals because, I mean, we're even making movies about it. We're, you know, showing how great it is. You should try to do it too, is the whole message. It's even become something that Baudrillard calls mass mediafied. If you look at the Emmys or the Grammys, or then these actresses and these high echelon people wearing a dress for one evening, it really signifies our wasteful society with its ties to affluence and status. They throw this dress away after one night or auction it off or whatever, because that's another symbol of that King Henry VIII taking one bite and throwing it away, wealth and status. Baudrillard further argues that what is produced today is not produced for its use value or its possible durability, but rather with an eye to its death, which has a lot to do with planned obsolescence and what we've learned from that. And that's the image there is just another example of how we're caught in this thing all the time and charged ridiculous amounts for it. Baudrillard also kind of focuses on or says that the car is one of the main foci of daily and long-term waste. So the car kind of represents that typical planned obsolescence and how we continue to destroy vehicles by using them, and they're built that way to be destroyed so we can keep buying other ones. And there's a huge waste involved in that, and obviously environmental impacts, not just with the materials used to build them, but also the waste that's used to maintain them and use them, such as gas and oil and all these other things. It's a terrible cycle that we're getting involved in. So he says the consumer society needs its objects in order to be. This is why destruction or waste remains the fundamental alternative to production. Consumption is merely an intermediate term between the two. So you can interpret that as you may. Basically, it just kind of says that, we have to keep wasting and destructing in order to perpetuate the society that we become a part of. So in knowing this, just a few class questions. Would you choose a life without a car? if you would, you know, you would be kind of adhering to a solution to something against this. And how else does your spending habits conform to this destruction and waste without maybe you knowing it? And how can we change this? Thank you.